Can everybody hear on you?
You are a guest there and he's giving a party and you are there like that.
Yes.
So I felt, because I had seen the unseen side of spirituality, or those who profess to be spiritual people, swamis, who had, swami means one who has control of oneself, isn't it? But masters of themselves. But they were not masters at all. So I had a very bad idea about saints and so-called saints, and those who style themselves as such. So the allergy was there.
Now when we have to say allergy was there.
Yes. That's a good way of putting it, right?
Secondly, you know, because Freud and others were saying that this love of God actually is fear of death. And the older you grow, or whenever you start fearing death in your life, at any moment, given moment, you start worshipping. Worshipping someone you don't know, whose existence is not sure, and you just feel that there must be somebody to cling to in times of the dying moments, isn't it? So this had gone deep into me. It was sort of a lesson drilled into me by Freudian psychologists. And I thought that all those devotees of God are actually afraid of death.
Are actually
afraid of death.
As for the saints were concerned, I told you already that so many of them were self-styled. And if I had come across some of them, they were people busy with property, going to courts to have a litigation settled in their favor. So they were much more materialistic sometimes than those who humble people who were not styling themselves to be saints. All this, you know, summed up meant that I was highly allergic, and you could see it why I was, isn't it? Now at that time, comes this gentleman talks of Mera Baba. So I just think that is yet another Baba. Is it? So I didn't really have that feeling. And when Bhav said that you come after you've done your MA, I thought, has it got to do with MA? Is he not evading the question that I asked him, that can you tell me of something which was before? Everything was, and nothing was before that. So he says that you come after you've done your MA. So this was, in some total, this was the way I was looking at the whole thing. And then I went to Mr. Muniraj's place, as he just literally took me by my hand and took me to his home. And the suspicion was there. That some of these people must be paid and doing a propaganda and telling people that this fellow is this fellow is this, only on payment basis. When I found how poor he was, wearing sandals carved out of tires, second-hand tires, sold in the...
Muniraj was that?
Yes.
He was as poor as that?
Yes.
Oh, poor Muniraj.
But I saw...
Surely he must have got the thought that the Mera Baba is paying him for the propaganda.
Yeah, that would be very clear about
it. Okay, that'd be clear.
And then I saw the books, you know, they were costly ones. One was Jean Adriel's Avatar. The other was with Dr. William Tompkins.
Wayfarers.
And there was Malcolm Schwartz's book. And there were quite a few English books. And he told me that
that's place.
Yes, he placed before me. And he said that he himself couldn't read them because he was not that much educated. But he kept them for learned people.
Like you.
People like you.
So, good propagandist,
sir. Yeah, he is feeling like, well, it's all right. It was all, you know, just to... But I thought he was trying to befriend me and get me into the coterie. So what I did was, I said, you are a smattering of English, don't you? He said, little. Sir, you have to read all these books to me. If you really care for Meher Baba and do care for my understanding him. So that was the torture I wanted to give him, just to know whether he was really in it. Or he was just a professional.
But he had to read them to you.
Yeah, I took him to all odd places. I was a very bad guy. And David must have been grinning his best, you know, to find one for him. So I took him to distant places, like parks, other places, and he would read and read and read till it was no longer possible to read when the sun had gone down. So we cried. So I tested him for about 3 weeks. I found that he was all the time so intensely occupied. Either I was grossly mistaken, he was a professional, I felt. I concluded he may be mistaken. There are two things, you know. A false man and a mistaken man. A man who is wrong but not false. So I didn't think that he was false. So he had earned my respect for this much, that he was really sincerely believing in him. I was God. So one day I took the books from him and started reading them. They were all from illustrious people. People from Padham. I had studied Padham in my course, MA course, as a person known as a Shakespearean critic. So I thought even Padham believes that Mehav is God and that sort of thing. Well, I read Padham, so what sort of guys are there around him? Now that was something. Then when I went for Dr. Donkin's book, my God, the real labor done with the best British acumen and intellect, best, I should say, perseverance.
Yeah.
So I started thinking, why in the hell do I think that I'm the only hard-working, honest man in the world? Are they all fools? Am I the only intelligent man in creation? So one day this thought struck. But then I said, no, don't give in. That is it. So I just talked to Muniraj one day. I said, Mr. Muniraj, who do you think Meher Baba is real? He said, well, I told you, he's God. Can God be there in human form? Said, yes, certainly. You can come in this world as a human being, I can come, he can come, this fellow can come, that, and God cannot come. So we are omnipotent, is important. No, Professor Hazra, that's not the way you should think about him. I'm an illiterate man, so I won't be able to argue with him, but don't think that God being omnipotent cannot come as man. I said, why is he silent? So he gave his own way, explained it for our good, he said, for our good, and he will break the silence one day when he thinks it's necessary. Well, I said, leave the books with
me. Why is he silent? So he gave some explanation and they said, one day he'll break his silence. So then he kept quiet.
Then I started thinking, because I had a friend who would be going on speaking and never allowing anybody to listen. So I thought that Meher Baba is the most civilized person that way. He is so silent, he doesn't speak at all, allows everybody else to speak, make the tale of his tongue. That was my feeling. Now,
very shrewd.
Then I took the books with me and I didn't torture him anymore and went through them. And one day I talked to him. It was a sort of sorting out things. I said, well, if he's God, let me find it out for myself. He said, yes, you're welcome to it. And that was the beginning. of the end of the quest of the doubter. So I just went inside my room and I thought, well, Baba, I wouldn't be asking you big things because I'm not greedy. I don't need also, because my father is rich enough. So we don't need anything. I am not very much given to worldly things. I don't want to own anything special. Just close to keep myself away from the nudist club and a little food to keep my body and soul together. So I'm not very much interested, except if it's a kind of books I like to. That too I'm now getting fed up there, because the books never lead you anywhere. So if you're God, if you really call it, it would be a wonderful thing in my life. It would be the end of my agony, my despair, my gloom, because I have not been able to find out any meaning of life, any meaning of the creation. I do not find anything. No answer has been given by chemistry or physics. They cannot tell you the purpose of life. They can just tell you about the construction of things. Isn't it? Not beyond that. And even philosophy doesn't seem to me very convincing. Lots of philosophers are there. If there are six, there are seven opinions. So Baba, if you are God, and you say you are God, the first person who has declared that he is God, you understand me? Swamis point out to God, but he points out to himself, I am God. So if you have to catch hold of anyone, if you have to fight with anyone, you can fight. It's a direct challenge. I am God. Now, come on. Come on. Like this. So I like it very much. And will you now give me small instances, illustrations of your Godhood? Though you are living many hundred miles away from here, you being omniscient, as Muniraj says, omnipotent, as he says, and omnipresent, you must be hearing me right here. So I'll try testing you, please. Give me, condescend at least, to give me some proof of your, evidence of your divinity. That was the beginning. That was the day the fragrant entry of the hero was in my life. I was there out on the sports field, and we were doing a lot of exercises. Eric Charles was our guide. And that day, Eric Charles, one gentleman, he was making us go for the short putt.
So, short putt?
Yes.
Short putt, you know, when you play sports? Yeah.
So we were...
Where, in which place?
In Jabalpur. So he wasn't satisfied with what we were doing. He said, still more, still more, strain yourself now, throw it for like this, at this angle. So we were pretty near done for that evening. And then we were coming back, I and my friend R&B, we were just parting ways at the time. Yes.
When we were coming back.
Coming back from the sports field.
Yeah.
My throat had gone pretty dry. And immediately at that moment, I was hardly half a kilometer away from my home at that time. I just made a prayer. Sumer Baba, I said, okay, if you are God, as Muniraj says, then can you give me a candy? Without my going to a shop for it, without asking anybody, without buying it, is it possible? Then I followed and went hurriedly, because I wanted to go for water and everything, to home. Now right about 20 feet from my home was standing one M.M. Dube, a senior man. I was just about 25 and a half, and he was nearing 40. He was standing there, he had a beard, so we used to call him Bulganin. So Mr. Bulganin Dube was standing there and he said, hello, I'm coming from sports field, pretty tired. We'll meet later on. Can we? No. Wait for a minute. I said, okay. I said, come on, have some candy.
So now, it was suddenly, what do you call it?
Sure.
So I looked at him and said, how come you are eating candy? Meaning, he is old enough, not for other reasons. He said, no, I got a bad throat, pharyngitis. So I thought I may share some with you. And then he went on. I said, wait, Mr. Dubey, why were you standing near my home? He said, well, I was going for a walk. Suddenly I stopped. I thought I would wait here. I'll go back. So you came. When I went for a glass of water and everything, suddenly the idea came, this was given by Baba. And then it came, now it is just a coincidence.
Yeah, coincidence.
And it went on and went on, and then another day came, I think two or three days later, my mother wanted some lemons to be brought from our market. She said, please go, because your sister, it does her good for her indigestion. So why don't you do it?
I said, get what liver?
Lemon.
I said, well, I'm not in a mood to go, I'm just reading a book. Oh, you unkind brother. Such brothers not wanted. You have no commiseration for your sister. She rebuked me and went in, my mother. She was such a good, nice creature. So I said, well, Mir Baba, if that candy wasn't that a coincidence, lemons will make it through. If you don't have to make me go to the market and mother is now angry, can you get me some lemons? This is the way it all started. And within, say, 5 minutes, there is a knock at the door. I open it and say, here are some lemons, sir. They have been sent by Dr. Ganguly.
Dr.
Ganguly. So I took the lemons. I said, mother, say, here are the lemons. Oh, you are a good boy. I went all the way to the market to get them so soon. He said, no, I didn't have to go, somebody brought them for me. Okay. Now, again, back to myself, I was thinking, what is all this? Is it again coincidence? Then third thing happened, you know, I have not mentioned in my book. I wanted my sister to write a letter to us. Now, that was absolutely impossible.
Because you wanted your sister to stay with you?
Because we didn't have news of her, and she was in Calcutta. And my mother was worried. So again, I prayed to Baba. Just the way I was doing it, requesting Baba, can we get a letter in a day or two? So, of course, there was no response or reply sort of thing. There was nothing like a trunk calling and all that. I just said, and then I got busy. And the next day, the postman came, the letter was there. Again, I relegated to coincidence. Like that, almost every day, day in and day out, I was testing Baba for everything, and everything happened. It happened, just happened. Even to the extent that I wanted, whatever I wanted, I got. But always the small things, according to my own promise, that I wouldn't be greedy, I wouldn't be asking for a dandy bus and that sort of thing. Till, you know, I got
not $1 million.
No. It was just little, just to see the ability of Mir Baba to give me all this. And it went on and on and on. And my friends whom I had made atheists, I was an atheist and didn't allow my friends to be atheists, they also were worried and concerned about me. They said, what's happening to him? Why is he lost? And then they started coming and telling me how they got things. Like R&B comes and says, well, Hazra Bhai, means brother, can I tell you something about myself? Come on, what's it? Said, today I wanted to eat mutton. And I told my family members to cook it. But my brother's wife really did not pay any attention and to my request. And I came back from office and asked if his mother cooked for me. She said, no. So I will not go to eat now. She said, no, please eat. And I will not eat since you have no mutton for me. And what happened? She said, I went to the room
and the way you were doing, I did the same thing to Mir Baba. I said, can I get some mutton to have with me? So I said, what happened then? He said, my brother had come back from state bank. He was an officer. He said, are you mad? At that time, they don't sell mutton. The shops are closed. Why don't you come and eat with us? Chapatis and dal and vegetables. He said, no, nothing to eat. I'm good. I'll not eat. I'll not take a mosque. Then what happened? He said, about 9:30 in the night, a jeep came. And a person came out of it and said, Mr. Bhattacharya, say, here's some mutton. A barking deer had been shot by a doctor and sent this. Please see that it must be immediately cooked because it was shot in the morning. And my Bhabhi Bhavi's brother's wife, who had not here, to cook anything for me or call for mutton. Now she rushed, barking deer, a leg of barking deer. And mutton was there, it was cooked by 11, I took. Now he said, you know better, what to say about it? I said, don't say anything. Keep your opinions suspended. Let many more waters flow by, then we will come to opinions and conclusions. It all went on and on and on. Meanwhile, you know, what happened was a miraculous thing. I started loving Baba. This is, I can't explain. Not because this candy or anything, not because this omnipresence of powers, just because I couldn't help it. Now in this world, you know, if you have to prize anything, you have to prize love. And the world will go to its doom soon if it doesn't have love. And love is something that only Baba can tell us how to do. I personally feel that we all fall short of loving. I'll end up this story by giving you one story in Bengali. The story of love. How you fall short of it. A small girl used to go to a grocer's shop to buy things. And she was very fond of the man who used to sell, because he would give her something free, like a toffee or a biscuit, like that. So she was so free with him that she took him not as a businessman, or almost like a person who loved her, small girl. And one day she asked for a loaf of bread. Now that was too much for that man. His name was Nebuda. Nebuda said, oh, a whole loaf of bread. Now, that would put me to loss. I can't give that to you. She said, no, please, Nebuda, give that loaf of bread. I want it. I don't want any toffee. I don't want this and that. Oh, you naughty girl. You will damage my business. I can't give it to you. So she went on asking till he was exasperated. And he gave her a hard slap. Said, get out of here. I won't give it to you. And she went out. Next day she didn't come. Day after next she didn't come. After 3 or 4 days he got a little cousin. She was living in the same neighborhood. So he thought he should go and just find out why she is not coming, and he may give a loaf of bread to her. So he took a loaf of bread. That I made a bad thing by hitting her this morning. When he went there, some people came out. Whom do you want? And they were looking disheveled, sad sort. She said, I wanted to meet this girl. She belongs to your home. But she was ill. And what happened to her? And a high fever. The doctors came, but they couldn't save her. My God, really? In the end, in the delirious state, she was saying, Nebuda, I'll never call. I've never asked you.
In the end, she said that.
And then you could find Nebuda for many years. His shop was locked. He was a beautiful man. Yes, having a look for bread, he was moving. this is what happens when you fall short of love. You not try to fall short of love. It's the real thing. If you are loving avatar Meher Baba, I don't know of others. If you love avatar Meher Baba, then you must love others. You must try to love others. If you cannot love others, at least don't hate them. Don't hurt them. And don't allow them to... If you, lovers of Meher Baba, cannot help people to come out of darkness, forgive them their omissions and commissions, you see, then what are we for? Why do we style ourselves as lovers of God and of Meher Baba? This is where I feel I must not put a full stop to what I was telling you, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Well, one thing you haven't mentioned through all this, then when did you actually meet Baba, come face to face, and did he say anything to you? You know, because everyone would want to hear just at least that, and then if you want to end it there. Because all this has led up to this, your disbelief, and then the doubts, and then questioning, and then all of a sudden you start having feelings for him. So, what happened at that face-to-face meeting?
He knows it all. Mm-hmm. I mean, she was there. It was like...
So what year was that?
Like meeting not only God, but Father. Eternal Father. The very first feeling that I had when he looked at me was... You have forgotten me.
You've forgotten me?
I felt, as if his eyes were saying, you have forgotten me. Am I not your father? Were you not with me always? It was like again meeting my long lost father, eternal father. I cannot express, you know, in words I'm a man of literature also. All professorship is useless. All your dictionaries lose their meanings. There are feelings that cannot be expressed. However deft you may be a Shakespeare, but you cannot do that.
Was it through Mooney? Did Mooney bring about the meeting for you to meet Baba?
Mooney,
yeah. Or was it a public passion?
I was already in love with Baba. I used to sleep with this photograph on my chest all night. I look at him and kiss him and go to sleep. Again get up, again kiss him. So I would powder his face in the photograph. I was just crazy. I was teaching grammar. Most sordid aspect of literature. So whenever we are teaching past tense and present tense and perfect and past perfect tense. But at heart I was weeping for the perfect one, not for perfect tense. And he has made it really present perfect. So I was just writing letters to the Mandi, I mean Eruch. And energy would be very cruel. So, no, Baba wants you not to come now during the vacation. You should not jeopardize your job. You should be, Baba wants you to do your job. You come in February during sevas. And see, I wasn't able to spend 1 hour without him. Just imagine, my condition. Then he writes again, I understand, but Baba wants you to do just. What is that?
Jap.
You wrote me a jap.
Jap.
Control.
Same thing.
Control. Control your emotions and not let a drop spill out of the cup Baba is filling with his grace. All that sort of thing was coming from him. But you know how difficult it is. No comfort and consolation to be derived from. So I got still more wild. One day, I was just about to throw Baba's picture on my bed. Smash it, because such a great... And immediately when Mr. Natarajan enters the hotel where I was staying in Bhopal, where I was a professor in government college, he comes in, and without asking me anything, he was not a Baba lover. He just came in, and I thought I should not smash the picture in this front when it looked so odd. So he just gently took it picture from my hand and took it to the bed and took the powder and did. I said, oh, yes, you got, you saved yourself. Then, of course, came the life-saving letter from Eruch. He wrote me a letter. Since you seem to be impatient, Baba permits you to come for a day only if you obey him, and not to bring anyone with you if you come. So I was so happy, so happy, so happy. You know, I went to Jabalpur and I couldn't tell anyone. So my mother wanted to. I said, first promise, one thing, that wherever I am going, to hell or heaven, you will not come with me. What do you say? Are you mad? Why should I go anywhere? And I said, no, I have to first extract a promise, because you are the only person I will be telling about where I am going. So you have to come. Okay, I'll not go with you, my son. I was the only son, no? And she loved me a lot. So she said, I'm not going, I promise. I promise. I'm going to see Meher Baba. Now she knew about Meher Baba because I had already pictures and books. So you're going here alone. You'll go. Oh, yes, yes. I didn't tell my friends. I didn't take anybody to the station for an escort. I went, I entrained and came to Pune. In the hotel, that was the, you know how in the, when you make 99 and get caught, and you cannot make a century in cricket, how do you feel? How bad? So it was like that. The Maharashtrian Brahmin came. It was Bhashai Lodge. Bhashai Lodge.
Bhashai Lodge, yeah.
Very good. So, of course, the manager wanted me to write why you have come. He said, as for sightseeing. I didn't tell him also. Now, this fellow comes with a cup of coffee and gives it to me. I said, I didn't ask for it. No, you don't have to pay. I just thought I'd give you a cup of coffee. So gracious, wonderful hotel, I thought. And then he looked at Baba's photo. By mistake, I'd taken it out, put it on the table. And he said, I was just wanting to know who is he. I forgot completely. I said, he's Meher Baba. Where is he? I said, right here in Pune. I have come for his darshan. And then I remember, my God. And then he said, oh, I'd like to go with you. So then, I avoided me and said, please, do not come with me. It will be a very big, big calamity for me. No? So, why? Because he doesn't want anybody to go with me. But you know, you can't stop me from going. I said, you can go, but after some time. You can go ahead of me or you can go behind me, but not with me. He looked at me and I went, of course, to Baba. And Baba came after some time. Nobody knew me, you know, that he had come. Nobody knew you, this guy. And nobody cared to know. Everybody was looking at the gate. It was just time for Baba to come in. And the blue car brought him in, along with Harris and others. And when Baba came, got down from the car, he was the most beautiful person I'd ever seen. And not only that, there was a throng. There was Avatar Meher Baba Ki Jai, Avatar Meher Baba Ki Jai. Lots of people, hundreds of people. I was looking at him. Before he went in, climbed the steps of the portico, he looked at me. This one went. Well, I was made to sit because they all rushed, you know. It was an unmannerly rushing in. I was not accustomed to that sort of thing. So they all rushed and I found myself seated just last but third row. And three turbaned Maharashtrian villagers, big turbans, just standing in front of me. Well eclipsed. So after say about 15 to 20 minutes, I started thinking, what is the use of coming all the way? Just to see turbans. How do you like this? And Baba was telling something about soldiers' obedience and slaves' obedience and lovers' obedience. All that discourses and Madhusudan's bhajans came up and still nothing. I said, well, am I wasting my time? And suddenly the turbans, two turbans passed. So one goes like this, one goes from Baba Baba looks and points with his fingers. And Eruchi is making gestures. So Eruchi looks at me and says, Amiya Kumar? Baba does not look. Oh, Amiya Kumar, Baba wants you.
Which year was it?
It was 1957, 8th of December, Sunday morning. The session was from 8 with a break up to 5.
At Guru Prasad.
Guru Prasad. Well, it all went on. Then I wanted, even there,
Guru Prasad was the palace of Maharani Shanti.
So, wait, Baba called you up, but what happened then?
Oh yes, when I was about to hook up to him, and I, you know, I was a sprinter also those days. Now, don't compare me from what you see today. Huh? A doddering skeleton sort of person now. But I was a good sportsman, great for college, great for club. So what happened was that suddenly my legs gave in. I wasn't able to walk. I thought as if I was wading through waters. Mm-hmm. Suddenly the atmosphere thickened. This is my feeling. Exactly this is what I felt like. I thought I would fall down. And halfway the aisle, I prayed. Oh, Baba, don't call me now. Anyway, she did like this. So Eruchi said, Baba wants you not to come now. You sit close by. So I was made to sit at a place from where I could see him without having those turbans. So Baba looked at me and said, are you able to see me? Yes. Then I started thinking, what a bad guy I've been insulting all the God-men, Ramakrishna Paramahansa, Vivekananda, and this Avadhut, that Swami, and Christ, and Muhammad, all these persons, and always thinking of science and pleasing science. Science is good enough, so far as the use of science is concerned, for good things. Otherwise, science has not been theoretically able to prove anything in the world. It's a mess. Even the greatest scientists have read, they are saying, Feynman says, let us call a halt to physics. Coherent says, science is but a dynamic concept of nature. Dynamic means a changing concept. Mm-hmm. Today you say voice, okay. Tomorrow you say it isn't. So it goes on like, I'm sorry, I cannot cut it short. I'll say that I made a prayer at heart. Baba, you know everything. You were fulfilling my request to sir. All those places away from you. You know even here what I'm thinking. I'm asking your forgiveness. Will you forgive me? Can you forgive me? So look at me. Amidst his discourses, how busy he was telling people, suddenly stopped and looked at me. What compassionate eyes. Tremendous. This cannot be got from churches or mosques or padris cannot forgive you. These mullahs, these Brahmin pandits can't forgive you. Only Baba can forgive you. The way he looked at me. It expressed. A million words could not have done it. It's what he did with just a single look. And he did that. Well, this story will become endless and I want to hear it achieved. Jai Baba.
Jai Baba.
Don't run again.
You can say
it. No, but all this leads me to think of the early years, you see, in the past as well. Where are you going?
No, he will take it. He wants to take it. Sankalpa's birthday is his birthday gift.
So what do you want?
He wants to take it. I want that he should bring the tape close to me.
Oh, okay. So, okay. What happened with that? Takes me to my past and present, you see. Past and present was Prophet Muhammad. Mm-hmm. And Baba says that he is the same ancient one having come again. That's what he says. And what happened, now see how many things come up in my mind, those years. He would say that I am the same ancient one having come again once again. And there will be Mohammedans, Sikh gentlemen, and Christians, and Parsis, and all that. They were there. So, Sri Baba says, how be? I am the same ancient one having come again. So one of them, to cut the whole story short, it's a long thing, one of them piped in and says, if you are the same ancient one, then I love Jesus Christ, so can I not continue life? I said, of course, fine. And then others said, and what about us Zoroastrians? Whatever, whomsoever you are following, whomsoever you are loving, continue to love with all your heart. But remember that I have come once again, I am the same ancient one. So love me with all your heart and soul. And people did not know what to say now. It was a sort of a confusion. And luckily, Amiya Kumar was not there. So, but Baba himself came out and tried to explain to them. You won't understand what I'm saying, Baba says. Okay. Now let me tell you a story. A real story, true story, because it happened at the time of the Britishers. British Empire was here in India. And Baba then inquired after these young ones who had come over there to him and said, have you ever heard of Quakeros? Yes. My mother is with me when I was a young man. And you? Yeah, we know Quakeros. Quakeros is a nice porridge you see every morning you used to have. You know Quakeros? You are not Quakeros. Oh, nobody you would have thought, no. Baba looked here and there. Oh, you all know about Quakeros? So this is the story about the Quaker Oats, Baba says. And people are wondering, what's the matter? The ancient one has gone crazy or what? From where is he? We keep quiet, and I also myself wonder, because I have to translate his gestures and all that. So he said, you know, some years ago, Britishers were here, and a British couple, big officer. He had an only son, the only son he had. And the mother was very anxious to make him grow hale and hearty and strong, and therefore she was very particular about morning porridge, Quaker Oat porridge. She was crazy about the Quaker Oats. So unfailingly, she would bring Quaker Oat porridge for him to eat. That's a usual thing, Baba says. But one morning, while she is giving Quaker Oat porridge to her son, she noticed that it was the last spoonful that was there in the box. And at the time, it was war time. It was very difficult here in India. Many things were happening at the time. And materials were not about what to do. So she was very much cautious about it, and she, soon after the breakfast over, she rushed to the shop. It's madam, mind you, a British lady. She goes to the shop where she used to go shopping every morning. And then goes there, she's very much upset whether there'll be Quaker Oats there. Where she went to the shelf where there was the Quaker Oats. She would find every time. And the shelves are all empty. Oh, but there's one Quaker Oat box there. And she's so happy. Immediately she plucked. She was so happy. This is what Baba is saying. Eh? I'm just trying to narrate to you what happened. So, man comes there. Madam, please don't take that. She looks sternly at him and says, why not? I will pay for it. No, it's not to be taken by you. No, you should please keep it by. Why not? Don't you know that I am the regular customer for Quaker Oats? Yes, that's the reason I'm saying don't take it. What do you mean by that? I want it for my son. No, please not. But why? Because madam, we know that you are fond of Quaker Oats and all that. We have received a fresh stock of Quaker Oats. We just now received a fresh dog, and I'll open it and give it to the fresh dog. So Baba says, looks at them and says, can you tell me who is that person who would insist on continuing with the stale stock of same vigorous? No, well, I am the fresh stock of vigorous. So that's how it was. Why not? Follow Zoroaster, I'm happy that you're loving me in him. I'm happy you're loving Jesus Christ. I'm happy you're loving Buddha. I'm happy you're loving Prophet Muhammad and all that. Continue with that. But know well that I am the same ancient one, but of the fresh stock. So that's what he said. So now from that story comes the one that I wanted us all to remember. And the story is at the time of Muhammad also. Well, you know how Prophet Muhammad was. Lived a simple life, he went for wars and he was beaten and this and that. All things going to happen and all that. And all the time he depended upon, Gabriel has come, yeah, there's a message from God. And that's how he would speak out loudly. Or sometimes there'll be loud echo in the room. And then there'll be some people who will be writing down what the message from God has come. It's nothing but the Quran. You see, have you heard the word Quran? It's that. So, that's how Muhammad protected his being the one, ancient one, at that time. But people naturally took him to be an ordinary person, and he is always. He always comes as an ordinary person. Otherwise, how can he mingle with us? So, they went on for years together. And one day he had come from some work and he's sitting there with his money and talking and all that. All of a sudden, with a jerk, the turban fell down. His turban, Mama's turban. So he picks it up and he's trying. And at the same time, he hears a voice. Allah, Gabriel, what is it? By the way, you are so close to Allah, isn't it? Have you, will you tell me, how does he appear to you? What do you see? He goes on dying. And the voice said, how is it possible for me, Rasulullah, to approach him so close to see him? So why not? You are so close, and why not? Why don't you go close to him and see, at least give a peep and inform us as to how does he appear, what is he? So he keeps quiet. Rasulullah, I'll try my best. The voice comes. So some months pass by. All of a sudden, once again, the voice comes. Yeah, wait, there's a message from the Lord. Gabriel is speaking. And he conveyed the message. The person is writing. And then he says, by the way, did you go close to Allah and see how, will you let us know how does he, what did you see, how does he appear to me? And he says, well, what I saw was an effulgent explosion of light, unfathomable, and in the midst of it, the radiance was there, in the midst of it, I saw you tying the turban. Not, you saw me tying the turban. Yes, that's all I could see. At that time, Ali, who was so close to Baba, to Muhammad, that he had some sort of thing, you know, to say, what is he, the same man, what is he, this, how is it? And then that was that he, Allah personified. Same ancient one. This is published in the book called the Hadith, in the words of Muhammad. The ancient one, the same ancient one, comes once again amidst, as man amidst man. Okay, now only 15 minutes more. Has Alaba come with you?
Yes. 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 Yes.
Oh God, and then we whistle. So what I'm saying is that Amiya Kumar was saying about love, how you started, all of a sudden started having love for us. But this reminded me something, because I must let you all know, it's a beautiful discourse that Baba gave one day. And he would say, love me and love me, and we would say, yes, love and love. You know, we have got 2 years, and here and this year passes by. But one day, as our persons came over here, says, Baba, we have been hearing you that you wanted us to love, and you want us to love you, and you want us to love you and love you. But how to love you? What is there any, is there anything to? How do you want us to love? Just laugh, you see, in the usual way, not loudly, but smile and say, what are you talking? Ma'am, question Baba, come to me. Are you married? Baba is asking me. Yeah. How did you fall in love with your wife? Well, I happened to look at her once, I spot her, seeing her beauty, I fell in love with her. Did anybody tell you to fall in love with her? No, I saw her face and fell. So that's how you should love me.
Yeah, I
see me as I am and fall in love with me. Not like this. This is a cover that I have put on. It's a cloak that I have put on. See me as I really am. Then all kept quiet. And Baba, of course, is really compassionate. And he says, how will you see me as I really am? How?
Yes.
Baba says, that all that you need is to just have a glimpse of me, and there's no end to loving me. But how will you have it? How will you see me? And then he said, well, for that is a long trail, and all that you need to do is to start from remembering me. Try to remember. Begin to remember. You know, how can you become expert in your language or anything, writing or anything? You have to begin with something, the A, B, C. So this is the beginning of your trying your best to see me as I really am. To remember. How will you remember me now? Shall I tell you how to remember me? Now I'm talking to you about loving me and trying to remember me. Just think of picture that I'm giving you that little discourse to remember me. Bring before your mind's eye what I'm telling now that will make you remember me. In your day-to-day work. Or do one thing. Take my photos and put them on the wall. That seeing the photos remember me. See me, put them in your bathroom, in your toilets also. See that you can remember me. And that's more important, to remember me. Time and again, every moment of your life you should remember me. So that's how you tell me that. And that would be Baba says, a mechanical reminder to remember me. You need to have reminders to remember me. So that will be a mechanical way of remembering me. When see my photo, doing this, and this is when Amir Baba's hair, and this and all that. It's a mechanical way of remembering me. But that is the beginning. But then what happens? A surge takes place in your mind. Baba is there.
One break. Time for lunch.
Too early. That's 10 minutes.
And so mind saying, but what does he want us to do apart from remembering him and all that? So, has he said anything? He goes out.
One break.
On reading things, poems book, and that book, and that book, and all that. And then what happens?
It's a mechanical way of remembering. It's the first stage of remembering. To remind him through what he has said. That reminds man about him. So he remembers him more ardently now. And then again there's an urge and surge in the mind. By the way, he has gone. I'm cutting short all this, you know, because of the way. So what happens is that he gets an urge now. Can I not go to the places where he had been? So I can know more about the person who met him. So he goes on now traveling. All over India he goes. From one place to another place, another place. Goes to a house. Have you heard of Mehr Baba?
Yeah,
he was.
I heard.
When he visits, oh really? And he goes to the neighbor. And he asks about Mehr Baba and this. And they tell their stories about their life and all that. And again, that it just goes on. But now, what happens is, apart from the mechanical way of reminders and all that, a little surge takes place in the heart. The cheek opens up. Cheek. And there comes out a little feeling about Mehr Baba. And that feeling just grows more and more, the more he goes to see people and contact them and all that, all over places. And then they say about the mask, you see, that is the mask that Baba saw, that's how we were taken out. I said, oh God, he's that. Mechanical reminders are there. Apart from that, there are these reminders and remembering him to feeling him. So there's no need now to look at his pictures or photos because he can remember him, he returns home after years of travel and contacting people. And he sits there in the summertime, Baba says, very, he's tired and does not know. This is Amiya Kumar was wanting to have a sip of water. So he goes there and Baba says there is a chetty of water where you have cool water. At that time there was no ice or anything. So he goes and drinks water from there. How cool the water is. But not the coolness that affects him, but that reminds him of the Lord, Mehr Baba, having travelled all over the place. How thirsty he must have been. What must have happened at the time when he must have gone out in the sun, and how refreshing the water could have been for him. How must he have felt? And so, at that time, the surge of feeling just pushes him, pushes out of his heart. Oh my, what a glorious life. And he sits down and looks at the creation and all that. What a creation. And Baba says, he looks out and sees, what sort of creation is that? Look at the green that he has created. Not one green, so many shades. Not one red rose, but so many shades of rose. Oh my, what is that? He begins to glorify God. Begins with his mechanical reminders, then comes to this stage where he has to remember him through feelings, and from feelings now he glorifies the Lord through all the creation. You see, anywhere he looks there, he just begins to, what, one shade of red? No, there is red and pink. And what is, even the red has different shades also of the red and yellow. And then, oh my God, he says, what is this? And he just gets crazy about it. And he goes on glorifying the Lord. No more seeing the photos, no more reading the book, no more wanting to know anything about Mehr Baba, but just glorifying the Lord. There's no words, no thought. Nothing but explosion of feelings and glory. And then Baba uses the word. That at that stage something happens, and with that, in the glory of his creation, all that he begins to see visually the glory of the Lord. In the glory of the Creator, he sees the Creator himself. and there is no end to that love for you. That's how you begin to love me. And you love me, and you begin to love, and you love me. The more he loves, the more he feels that he should love, and he is not satisfied with the love, and he wants to love me more and more, and more and more, and still yet more and still. There is no end to his loving. He does not want to eat, does not want to sleep, does not want anything to do with anybody. But then, Baba says, what can we say? An accident takes place in his life. And this accident, he thought because he does not care for himself that he must have met with an accident. He died? No, Baba says, a different type of accident. What is that? You know what that accident is? The lover loves the beloved. Now when he sees the beloved and begins to love the beloved with such intensity that the beloved becomes the lover and the lover becomes the beloved of the lover. So the lover and the beloved change hands. I become the lover of the beloved and the beloved becomes my lover. So that is called union, realization. He's no more there. Did you all follow this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Amiya ji, did you follow?
No duality.
Huh?
Yeah.
That's the stage.
That's the end of it. That's the end of the story. That's the end of the day.
And now we end the session, and it's time for us all to have lunch.
Mm-hmm. Mama still 5 minutes more.